We are in the middle of a revolution in industry, in innovation, and technology. And it's a revolution driven by two important breakthroughs: the availability and expanded use of sensors that collect data from moving parts of machines, and the cloud that takes the data collected by those sensors and stores the data, analyzes the data, and puts the data to work for businesses, governments, healthcare, energy providers, you name it. This revolution will change the future of work and change it for the better, and it's changing it quickly. It took about 100 years for us to get from the Industrial Revolution to the Internet Revolution, but only about 20 years have passed since the dawn of the Internet age and this latest revolution, what we at GE call the Industrial Internet, which is part, the first major factor in the first driving force in the future of work. But an economic funk that the Eurozone has been in for several years threatens to leave parts of Europe on the sidelines of this new revolution. With the exception of Germany, the Eurozone recovery from the two-headed monster of the global financial crisis and the Eurozone debt crisis has been much weaker than in other parts of the world. For instance, in US and Canada, output has risen from 2007 levels by 11% and 8% respectively. In Spain and Italy, output is still below 2007 levels, and even in Germany in France and the United Kingdom, output is just about 2% over the 2007 levels from that point. So less than 2% growth or no percent growth in output in many parts of the Eurozone since the beginning of the crisis age here in Europe. One reason why output has been held back is because productivity in the Eurozone has lagged. It has been assumed for decades that Europeans, though working fewer hours than Americans, were just as productive as their counterparts across the pond. The assumption was that Europeans got the same amount of work done, but in less time than American workers. Though true through the 1990s, labor productivity data shows this is no longer the case. Output per worker and output per hour worked show that European workers, even ones within stronger economies like Germany and in the UK, are not as productive as their counterparts in the US. And this is not said to prop up the US worker as an exemplar of productivity. It's simply stated to show that Europe has the potential to strive to be more competitive and to be more productive. With output and productivity down, a resulting wave of declining business and consumer confidence is inevitable. This cycle leads to a lack of demand for credit, which hinders investment in innovation. And while credit demand is off, the supply of credit is also a hindrance to investment and growth, as Eurozone banks remain reluctant to lend in the face of ongoing stress tests that require increase in capital stock. Another issue facing Europe's ability to maintain competitiveness is one of demographics. And this is not just a Eurocentric issue. This is an issue that is facing the globe. Countries like US, Japan, and even China will be faced with shrinking working age population over the years and decades to come. In fact, some are already facing these realities. The threat of a shrinking working age population brings two issues to the fore. The first is the ability of governments to continue to provide entitlement programs that are funded by tax revenue. A shrinking working age population goes hand in hand with an increasing old age population. People who are receiving pensions and healthcare benefits but are not still part of the workforce and paying into those programs. Secondly, a shrinking working age population creates a supply crunch for available talent, which obviously drives up labor costs. These demographic issues will lead to a race to win the greatest minds, thinkers, and innovators, a global competition for talent. The working age population is not going to be solved by a baby boom, even if an increase in the birth rate occurred. Even if William and Kate have twins, like it's suggested, right? It would take 15 to 20 years before the first of those babies join the workforce. The countries and regions that win this competition for talent will be the ones that organically grow their workforces. There's several ways they can do this. The first is the winners will erase gender inequalities in terms of social acceptance of women in the workforce, and they'll break through glass ceilings in terms of pay for women. The winners will also be the ones that make immigration reforms, allowing the best talent from outside of the country or the region to work on the same footing as domestic employees. And this one's going to get a lot of groans, but just because we are living 10 years longer than we did 50 years ago does not mean we get to spend those extra 10 years in retirement, okay? The winners are going to be the ones that understand that as our life expectancy increases, our retirement age should increase as well, keeping more people in the workforce longer so that they can pay into public support funds instead of just being drains on them. I want to stress again, this is not just a European issue. A large portion of the US population believes immigration laws should become more strict, not more open. The idea of integrating more women into the workforce flies in the face of social norms that have been alive for generations in Japan. And China only recently took action to adjust the one-child policy that is negatively impacting the size of their workforce. So the door is open for countries within the Eurozone to take advantage of this situation. And one way Europe can take advantage of it is to address the skills gap that exists in the population in the labor force. While unemployment rates remain at record highs in many parts of the Eurozone, there are millions of jobs available that are going unfulfilled. Those looking for work lack the skill sets needed to succeed in the future of work. Training must be provided to bridge this gap, and it's the responsibility of not just businesses, but governments and also administrators of higher education to plan and develop programs that will help align the curriculum vitae of those looking for work with the job descriptions of those looking for workers. So attracting the best talent is one of the keystones to competitive success in the new revolution. But results from GE's Innovation Barometer, a survey of business innovation leaders throughout the globe, show that European executives are less likely to believe this than their counterparts in other parts of the world. Attracting and retaining talent, encouraging disruptive and creative behavior from your employees, these need to be paramount concerns of today's business leaders. Another difference in how European respondents to our survey saw innovation was in collaboration. And this is a trend we have seen for 2 years now in our Innovation Barometer. Last year, collaboration was just an idea that many respondents talked about. This year, many businesses reported that they have seen increased collaboration and they've actually seen increased revenues from collaborative efforts with companies outside of their own walls. And this trend towards collaboration challenges the way we think about business. The ability to collect and analyze countless amounts of data and the need to be faster to market, and I'll talk about being faster to market in a bit, it changes the paradigm of collaboration. And collaboration in this technological revolution does not just mean collaboration with vertical firms that complement your existing product lines. It means collaborating with suppliers, with customers, and with competitors. But responses to our survey show that Europeans were more likely to prefer to keep the creative process within the walls of their businesses. And this attitude will place Europe at a competitive disadvantage. It is becoming necessary to collaborate with small and medium-sized firms, to work more closely with suppliers and distributors to increase product cycle times, and to safely share data with competitors to better understand market trends. We see collaboration playing out as part of another fundamental force of the future of work, the global brain. Cloud computing and connectivity have spurred the ability to capitalize on the collective intelligence of all human beings. Open sourcing and crowdsourcing are ways for large companies to tap into the expertise of individuals, of entrepreneurs, across the globe. We've undertaken this at GE in several ways. One example is a program called Flight Quest, where we made flight arrival and departure times, data around that, available to the crowd, and we challenged the crowd to improve gate turnaround times at airports. Collaboration is also advantageous to workers, not just to businesses. Workers, entrepreneurs, get the ability to tap into the resources of large companies and also to maintain entrepreneurial control of what they're doing. In the case of FlightQuest, the resources that we provided were the data and the prize money offered for the most innovative solutions. The increase in the sheer number of people that will be able to take part in the innovation process through collaboration will not only accelerate research and development, but will allow for a broader pool of thinkers to add their expertise to product development, creating the potential for new and greater innovations. But it's not just businesses that need to think about, that need to adjust their thinking in terms of innovations. Public policies around innovation need to be streamlined to help improve Europe's competitiveness. Short-term fixes are not enough. Long-term policies and objectives need to be put in place that overarch election cycles, so that when businesses and business leaders, they have to have faith that when a new government is elected or brought into control of a country, that the innovation policies that were put in place by previous administrations are not going to drastically change. Policymakers also need to work to creating a single market for innovation within the Eurozone. And this challenge is made tougher in Europe because of different cultural differences, including language. And those are barriers that are not faced in the United States, though I'm sure some New Yorkers have just as much trouble understanding a Texas accent as French, German, and Spanish people have understanding each other too. But in the US, the population is more mobile. And with more mobility comes mobility of knowledge and mobility of capital. The brightest minds from Nevada, from Florida, from Michigan, they flock to innovation hubs in the United States, in the Silicon Valley, in New York, and in the Research Triangle in North Carolina. A single market for innovation in the Eurozone would help expand these types of hubs here, like here in Bavaria, Aviation Valley in Poland, Nufaro Tech Campus in the Czech Republic, and in the UK, hubs like Tech City and the Motorsport Valley. These new places are where the brightest talent can gather together to bring new products from ideation to commercialization. Creating long-term consistent objectives are important. A single market for innovation is important for the Eurozone. But what's most important, the most important thing that the government can do to provide a leg up for innovation is investment. And our innovation barometer showed that European business leaders, more so than business leaders from across the globe, feel that governments are not doing enough to support innovation. Only about one-third responded that they believe governments and public authorities allocate an adequate share of budgets to support innovation, and only 70% believe there's not enough done to support SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises. It is possible that austerity measures have borne this belief that governments are not doing enough to support innovation. While the debt to GDP ratios ballooned as governments tried to cushion the impact of the financial crisis, shrinking those ratios through austerity measures will impact public investment in infrastructure and education, and it will hinder innovation. But there does not need to be a trade-off between austerity and investment in innovation. In fact, investment in innovation must take priority and should be protected, but austerity measures can still be implemented. With public spending as high as 50% of GDP in many countries here in the Eurozone, there are bound to be other programs that can afford haircuts without impacting budgets that are earmarked for research and development. And innovation has the power to raise economic growth, to deliver financial resources to an economy, to promote debt sustainability, but also at the same time provide funding for social safety nets. Prioritizing innovation does feed the economy. One of the biggest decisions facing innovators today is how quickly to get to market. And there was a definite divergence in thought in our innovation barometer. It was almost 50-50 of companies believing they need to be quicker to market versus companies that believe they need to spend more time on R&D before coming to market. And this wasn't a finding just in the Eurozone. This is globally. Some firms will continue to undertake extended research and development processes, testing and retesting products, testing with customers, technologically testing before coming to market. On the opposite side are firms that believe speed to market is imperative. And it's advances in the final factor of what we call the future of work, additive manufacturing or 3D printing, that will determine what adjustments need to, that will help move us to a more speedy market introductions. Additive manufacturing will allow entrepreneurs to take their products to market and then determine what adjustments need to be made. They'll be able to gather feedback from customers and quickly change specifications on the fly. Additive manufacturing will allow for customization of products to meet specific customers' needs. Multiple versions of products easily produced and quickly brought to market. And it's my belief that speed to market will win out. Those innovators who get to market first will be the champions of industry, especially as customers begin to understand this new wave, this new revolution, this new wave of production. The days where the advantages of being second to market, where laggards capitalize on the shortfalls in design, utility, and even marketing of product innovators will end in the wake of this new revolution. So don't just be a part of the revolution, strive to lead the revolution. The Eurozone is in a great position to take advantage of the opportunities that exist as part of the revolution. The changes needed to be more innovative, to be more productive and competitive, they're not ones that need to take 5 and 10 years to implement. They can be implemented quickly and they will have immediate and quick effect. Efforts focused on the points I mentioned: speed to market, creating a single market for innovation, collaboration with non-traditional partners, and developing and mobilizing talent could be started and achieved fairly quickly and with limited cost. There's a phrase that has become popular lately, and it's make sure you're on the right side of history. And this phrase is very appropriate when it comes to the innovation revolution we're a part of. History will show that advances we've made during the first part of this century will change the structure of innovation, the speed of innovation, and the profitability of businesses that prioritize innovation. The future of work will be defined by the industrial internet, additive manufacturing, and the global brain. It is essential that as business leaders, we understand that we have to be at the forefront of this revolution. We must be on the right side of history. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the program.